بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
A presentation of Quran Sunnah educational programs. Visit us online at www.qsep.com.
الإيمان بالكتب.
Faith in the divine books of Allah.
الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله. The topic today inshallah will be about the faith in Allah's books. Our faith in the books means four things. First, to have faith that they have been sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have been spoken by Allah, actually. Allah spoke the Torah just like He spoke the Injil, just like He spoke the Quran. And Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe that the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a true speech. It is letters, and it is by a voice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jibreel heard it from Allah, the angel heard it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he took it down to the messenger. And then we have to have faith in their names according to what have been mentioned in Quran, like the Torah, which was the book sent down to Messenger Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, the Injil, which is the Bible that was sent to Messenger Jesus Eesa alayhi salatu wassalam, and Zabur, which was sent to Dawood alayhi salatu wassalam, and Suhuf Ibrahim, which were sent to the messenger Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam, and the Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the final messenger of Allah. There are other books which have been sent down to the messengers. We know that there are 314 messengers, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has mentioned them, and they all had books from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not tell us about the names of all the books, just like He did not tell us about the names of all the messengers. So our duty is to have faith in all the books. Our faith in those books also, that all those books taught the same fundamentals, because the religion of Allah is one. Since they all come from Allah Himself, then they cannot be different. The main message is the same: to worship Allah alone, and not to worship others besides Him, and not to associate partners with Him in any way, and not to set up rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyone who comes with anything against this concept and attributes it to the Bible or to the Torah or to any other heavenly book, then he is definitely lying, and he is saying falsehood. Nothing which contradicts the main fundamentals of Islam can be from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one criteria to know what is true and what is false in the previous books. When we say the books, the other books, in regards to the fundamentals, they should be the same if they are not messed with. But in regards to what is lawful and unlawful, few things might be different. Originally, it was different. Why? Because that order was suitable for that time. It was unlawful at that time, but it was made lawful for us, or the opposite. But they are not different in the fundamentals of faith. Their faith in Allah, their faith in the hereafter, in paradise, in hellfire, in making salat, fasting, zakat. Generally, these are the same teachings. But this takes to follow the unaltered scripture, the unaltered Bible, the unchanged, you see. But what we have nowadays in our hands is not the true Bible. Most of them are changed, you see. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, He sent down the prophets giving glad tidings and warnings. And He sent down the books with them, with the truth. So all the books of Allah were sent down with the truth. There is no book of Allah which was sent down with any kind of falsehood. Therefore, we know that whatever we see in contemporary Bibles that does not match with Quran, then this is a deviation. The Jews, for example, have in their texts, in their changed texts, they have that the Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salatu wassalam worshipped idols. And if you go to the Old Testament, it says in Genesis, he, meaning Ismail alayhi salam, or Ishmael, he will be a wild donkey of a man. Look how an ugly of a deviation is this. To call a messenger of Allah, an honorable messenger of Allah like Ismail, the son of Ibrahim, to call him a donkey and to picture him in such an ugly way, this is great kufr in Islam. Any Muslim who dares to slander any prophet is a kafir. He is a rejecter of faith. He is in hellfire forever if he does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the Jews attributed to Lut alayhi salam that he drank until he became intoxicated or drunk. Then he committed fornication with his daughter. They also attributed fornication to Dawood alayhi salam. And based on that, Sulaiman was the son of a fornicator, as they claim. And the Christians also claim that all prophets, the Israelite prophets, were thieves. And this is in a testimony of Jesus regarding them. So these are just examples, few examples. Actually, if you go and see the contemporary Bibles, you will find so much deviation and so much alteration of the original texts. Jesus is called a lamb. He's a lamb. And many things like that you find in their books. The worst of those deviations, to say that Jesus was put on the cross, spit on, nailed with nails, and finally killed. This is the worst, because in this they claim that Jesus was shouting, saying, "Eli, Eli, lima shabaktani?" Oh my God, why have you forsaken me? How could Jesus say this? If indeed he was crucified, he would not think of God as someone who has forsaken him. This is a big contradictory statement. How could someone believe this and at the same time say, he is Jesus, he is the Son of God? How could he be the Son of God or God and put on the cross like that and spit on and nailed and killed and all that? What kind of nonsense is this? But they believe in it. And as one priest told me once, we know that this is contradictory, but we have to believe in it. This is the way they go. But in Islam, alhamdulillah, the faith is easy, non-contradictory. Everything is in its place. which shows that Allah has protected Quran because it is the final message and the final book. The Quran, which is the final book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, abrogates all the laws that have been sent in the books before Quran. In other words, we should believe that the Bible is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, it was the truth for that time. All of it, you see? All of it was the truth for that time for the people who were ordered to follow Jesus alayhi salam. Okay? But when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, then anyone who was following that Bible would find in the Bible itself that he should follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he would find the description, exact description of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just like Hercules did. He found the description and he was about to become a Muslim. But since he was the ruler, the king, his priests threatened him. So he was fearful for his position. So he did not become a Muslim, you see. While his friend in Amuriya, another priest, was only a regular priest. He was not a king. He was a poor man. He became a Muslim and he was killed at that time. Okay? So our duty towards the books that exist nowadays, the Bible and other books, that they are mostly changed, not the original books, okay? But if someone brings us an original Bible, we respect it. But we don't follow what's in it because we have Quran. We don't need to look into it because we have Quran and we have Sunnah. This is the final message and it abrogates everything. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got very angry at Umar radiallahu anhu. When Umar once came with the Torah and he wanted to show the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam something in Torah which Umar thought that we have in Quran or something like this. So he was, while he was reciting, the Prophet was getting angry. And Umar was not paying attention to the face of the Prophet ﷺ when he was getting angry. But when Umar paid attention and he saw the Prophet angry, he stopped immediately and he became very fearful. And he came down on his knees, fearing that Allah might punish him because of the anger of the Messenger ﷺ. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, "What kind of risk are you taking, O Umar, by doing this, by reading? You don't do this. If Musa was alive now, he would have no other way but to follow me." You see? And he would leave the Torah, which was revealed to him by Allah, and he would follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you want to call Christians to Islam, it's okay to know the contradictions in the Bible and things like that, which will help you to call them to Islam. Okay? That's okay. It's okay to look into those books for the advantage of those people, to bring them to Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although he got angry with what Umar did, he also said, this is in Sahih al-Bukhari, he said, "Hadithu an Bani Israel wa la haraj." Narrate that which you receive from Banu Israel, the Jews, and there is no problem in that. Okay? So there are things you can narrate. You can, like, for example, the details of stories which are mentioned in those books, but not mentioned in Quran. Those details, as long as they do not contradict Quran and Sunnah, it's okay to accept them. You see, it's okay to accept them. We have even some companions who used to go and ask rabbis and priests about those details. What's in their books regarding them? Okay. Even some companions were doing this. We have students of companions who were doing this. We have companions who were priests before becoming Muslims. Like Abdullah ibn Salam was a Jew. He was a scholar of Judaism. Okay, like Adi ibn Hatim al-Tai, Adi was a Christian priest, you see. We have one of the students of companions whose name was Wahb ibn Munabbih. He was a Jew before becoming a Muslim. He was a Jewish scholar, knowing their books in detail, you see. So they carried some of those details to others. As long as those details are nothing which contradicts our faith or our rules.
Preservation of the Quran.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not preserve or promised to preserve the other books. But he promised to preserve Quran. Why? Because it is the final message and it is for everyone. Therefore, Allah has promised to preserve it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, "Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun." We have revealed or we have sent down the revelation and we will protect it or preserve it or guard it. That's why Quran that we have nowadays in our hands or in our hearts is the same Quran that was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As a matter of fact, we have the original copy of Quran which was written down and collected by the Khalifa Abu Bakr ibn al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, the greatest companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Quran was being written down by the companions at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not by special companions but by all companions. It was permitted for every companion to write down Quran, just like he was permitted to memorize it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not permit the companions in general to write down his sayings because he did not want it to he did not want to confuse people so that they might mix Quran with his sayings. Therefore, he gave a general order not to write what he says. That was in his time. And despite that order, some companions came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked for a special permission to write down what he says, and he allowed them, like Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhuma, and some other companions. The remembrance which is referred to in Quran here in this verse, "Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikr," we have sent down the remembrance. The remembrance includes both the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran also, "وَأَنزَلَ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ." He has sent down to you both the book, which is Quran, and the hikmah. Hikmah is sunnah, as Imam al-Shafi'i explained it, and he quoted all the scholars that hikmah means the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why Hassan ibn Atiyah said, Jibreel was coming down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with sunnah, just like he was coming down to him with Quran. And he was teaching him the sunnah, just like he was teaching him the Quran. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a true hadith, I have been given the Quran and an equal to it with it. And what is equal to Quran but the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said also in another narration, أَلَا إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ كَمَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ. Whatever the Messenger makes unlawful is like what Allah made unlawful. So this is very clear to show that Sunnah is part of the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it very clearly in Quran about what the Messenger says, مَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. That he, meaning Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, does not speak of his own. It is nothing but a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was angry during one of his speeches, he was speaking with anger. So one companion hesitated to write down what he was saying. And he asked the Messenger, should I write down what you just said when you were angry? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, write down, by Allah, nothing comes out of this mouth but the truth. So this is what the Book of Allah means. What is also very important in regards to the Book of Allah, the Quran, is the tafsir or the explanation of Quran. The way of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah is first that we explain Quran by Quran itself. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, describing his book, saying, كِتَابًا مُتَشَابِهًا مَثَانِي. متشابه here does not mean متشابه in other verses, no. متشابه here means similar. So also the word مثاني